Now, if you're the type of person that like to drive a car that's a cut above the rest, then today's video is for you. We're going to go over 5 high performance cars that didn't take off in South Africa and today make a very good purchase in the used car market. My name is Kurt from wheelindex.co.za, the place where South Africans go to do research when they're buying or selling a car. So let's get into it. The first car on this list is the Golf 7 GTI Club Sport S. Now, South Africa, there was only 47 vehicles destined for South Africa of the Club Sport S. And when this car came out, it was so rare that I couldn't go to a dealership and test drive one. The dealerships that I went to all told me that the car is unavailable, that all the cars that were destined for South Africa have already been sold out. So there wasn't even cars available to test drive. And what happened was that private dealerships in South Africa, they snapped up quite a few of these cars and they marked them up ridiculously. I mean, this car, the list price was about 750 when it came out, 740, 750 when it came out. But there were dealerships, private dealerships, not brand dealerships, so not Volkswagen, private dealerships in and around the country advertising the car for R1 million. And that's like making a car a classic before it even became a classic. And that's really what was the issue with the Club Sport S. It set Nürburgring records and it's a purist car, doesn't have any back seats, it's lightweight, it makes the same kilowatt as the Golf 7R to 28, so it's not significantly faster, but it was a two-door model and South Africans, we don't get two-door models of Golfs since like probably the 80s when we last had the Mark 1 GT. So the exclusivity of the Golf 7 GTI, did it have the exclusivity? Absolutely. Was it worth the price of a used GTR, a used R8 when it just came out? Absolutely not. And many of those dealers, they never ended up selling those cars. That's why today you can buy a Club Sport S for about $599, which is a fantastic price. And you're gonna find a car that is extremely low mileage because most of the people who bought these cars back then, they bought it as collector cars and the car never took off. And now you can actually get your hands on one. They're all going for today in 2019 between $599 and say about $699. That's the higher end. But I mean, for quite significantly less than what the car launched for, you can get yourself into a Club Sport S today that probably has some warranty left, that's super low mileage, and it's taken a big depreciation knock, and yeah, you can get yourself into one of those. Car number two on our list is the Ford Focus RS Mark III. Now, RS stands for Rally Sport, and it's really a badge that's been placed onto Ford cars that are super special. I'm talking really, really special cars. We're talking about the Ford Escort, Cosworth RS. That is a fantastic car from the 80s. It set new benchmarks in performance and technology. And today that car is an absolute collector's item. Then we have the Ford Focus range, which in the Ford Focus Mark 1 that was made popular in the late 90s, early 2000s with Colin McRae winning many world championships for Ford, and that was a car that celebrated the rally. And then we never got that car in South Africa, the Mark 1. What we did get was the Mark 2, which was an instant hit. 2.5 cylinder turbo, car was retailing about for 450, between 450 and 500,000 when it came out. And even today in 2019, that car kept its value significantly well, and you can almost still pick them up for that price. Although this lower end of the range, you can get them under 400, but that's a car that has retained its value extremely well over the past years since 2011 till now. Now let's chat about the latest car, which is the Ford Focus RS Mark III. Now this car came out, it was marked up at $699,000. And when it came out, it was competing directly against the RS3 and the AMG A45. And many people will say that on a performance level, those cars were actually, they're just better. They're just better cars. So in its shadows, this Mark III had to live up to two really, really special cars that came before it. And the big question was, is it going to go up in value? and it didn't. It actually never went up into value. Although they had cool gimmicky features like the drift mode and that, the main issue with this car was really the reliability of the car. People were complaining very early on in 2016 and in 2017 that there were issues with the car overheating, and it was going viral on YouTube. People were putting up YouTube videos of the 2.3 EcoBoost engine with cylinder head issues and people's cars smoking when they started from cold. And Ford eventually did recall the vehicle for overheating and head gasket problem, but that's all things that didn't play in its favor for it to become a future classic car. And unfortunately, the car's taken a very big depreciation. Today it's about 40%, and you can pick these cars up for $450,000, which is basically the same price as what you can pick up a very clean, rare Mark II Focus RS. So the Mark III Focus RS, there was really there was big expectations of the car, but unfortunately the boots was, according to me, too big to fill. And the timing was wrong. Yes, we went with a 2.3 cylinder engine. The car is faster. The car does have all-wheel drive. Was there an improvement in technology? Absolutely, yes. But the car just lost its cult status. And that's great for you if you want to get yourself into a Focus RS. The third car on our list today is the Honda Civic Type R FK2. Now, the first time I heard about this car was online when it was breaking Nürburgring records. And unfortunately, the number one on our list, the Club Sport S, dethroned the record, the front wheel drive record at that time. But this car really made headlines because of its performance at that time. But somehow there was something just fundamentally Type R missing from the car. And I think that is the fact that Honda went turbo with the Type R. Now, I think this was going to be inevitable simply because of the emission standards that is worldwide and the pressures that the manufacturers are under in order to build cars. And you know, if they want to build high performance cars, there's still stringent emission laws and regulations that they need to meet in specific countries all over the world. And I think when it comes to performance, the best way to get more was eventually for Honda to go turbo. And Type R is unfortunately not known for boost, but known for its normal aspirated screaming engines. And that's how I know Honda. I've always wanted a VTEC. I've never owned one. If I would buy a VTEC, I would want that car to scream all the way up to 9,000 RPMs. And I think that's one of the biggest characteristics of the car that was lost when it came out. And I think the car never took off, in the sense that there was big anticipation for the car. People were excited for the car. Was the correct ingredients in the pot? Absolutely. Aerodynamics, Brembo brakes, type of Revo knuckle suspension to deal with the extra power, give you that little bit of traction when you come out of the corner on the track, on your track day, or wherever you might use the car to test its suspension abilities. All the ingredients was in the pot, but somehow people just never latched onto the new Type R. And when it came out, this car was priced at $600,000. And today, just a couple of years later, like 3 years later, you can actually buy these cars for $350,000, as low as $350,000, which is an absolute bargain, because that's the price of a used Golf 7 GTI, of a used Megane. So you can really get something that's absolutely special on the Honda side for what they call pennies on the dollar. I haven't driven the car yet. I think it's a great car. I think it's a good looking car. From what I've heard, people say that the suspension is a bit hard for daily drive though. I know it's got a very low profile tire, but at the end of the day, it's a purist performance type of car that you buy. That's really for the hardcore enthusiasts. But if you're in the market for a Honda Civic Type R, the time to buy that car is now. There's great deals to be had. Car number four on our list today is the Jaguar F-Type SVR. Now, this car is crazy. Now, when I say crazy, I mean supercar crazy. Let me just get into the specs for you. Kilowatt 423, Newton meters 700, suspension all-wheel drive, 0 to 100 3.7 seconds. Now, just from those stats, you can already see that we are talking about a special car here. And in actual fact, this car is also built by a team at Jaguar called SVO, which is Special Vehicle Operations. That's the department that's responsible for building all the super crazy models for Jaguar, that's SVR badges. Now, let's talk about the SVR from a vehicle's perspective that didn't take off and what this car actually is. Now, the F-Type is really a good car to get yourself into a coupe that has some heritage as a brand and that's more orientated as a performance vehicle. It's more orientated and it's a bit more special than your average brands that you get out there. That's really what you get with a F-Type Jaguar. So let's talk about the models that you get before you get the SVR. You get the V6, which I think is a very, very good option for somebody who just wants to get into an F-Type. You can get them for $599, under $600, very good buy. Then you get the V8 Supercharger, which is 3.8 seconds 0 to 100. It's a really, really fast car. And then after that, you get the SVR, which is based off the 5-liter V8 supercharger. So there's some enhancements that you get in the SVR that you don't get in the normal 5-liter supercharger. Now, the difference in price between the SVR and the normal 5-liter supercharger is astronomical. At the time in 2016 when this car came out, the normal 5-liter supercharger was about 1.5 million and this one, the SVR, was 2.1 million rand. So there was a shocking 600,000 rand difference in price for the special model. Now, this car is, as I explained earlier, completely insane. It's a supercar. But it's a car that just never really took off in the way that Jaguar envisioned it to be. Yes, there was all the great ingredients in the pot. You could add ceramic brakes, you could save another 21 kilograms. But when you look at the two cars, the 5-liter supercharger and the SVR, if I'm the buyer, there just wasn't enough differences between the two cars to justify 600,000 rand. And I think that's the real issue with this car. If I was F-Type buyer back in 2016 and I was looking at the two cars, cosmetically the upgrades on the SVR was very minimal compared to the standard 5-liter V8 supercharger that you got. And this car has taken a very, very big depreciation. Now, in 2016 this car was 2.1 million and today you can pick them up for as low as 1.2, 1.3 million rand. So if you want to buy yourself the top of the range F-Type, have all-wheel drive and have a coupe with a supercar power, really, that's what I would call it, the Jaguar F-Type SVR is the car for you, and you can get yourself a very good deal and a bargain, in fact, on this car, because they will all be very low mileage. You'll likely still have some maintenance plan on the Jaguar. And get yourself one of those. Car number 5 on our list have been giving South Africans pedestrians next range since 2014. That car is the BMW i8. I drove the BMW i8 when it just came out, and sadly to say, I wasn't impressed by the car. I expected supercar performance, and what I got really was high performance V6, V8 type of performance. It was released as a very technology advanced car, which it still is today. It's a hybrid vehicle, so we have electrification and we have a petrol engine as well. But the performance of the car for me, it just wasn't there. I didn't feel at that time like I was driving a 1.7 million rand high performance car back in 2014 when the car came out. And on top of that, what didn't play in its favor, specifically in South Africa, is the fact that South Africans are not very big on hybrid vehicles and EV vehicles. We don't have a charging network in South Africa where you can actually take your supercar, your hybrid supercar, and drive it significant distances and quick charge it when you get somewhere else. You can't do that. It's not yet possible. Yes, there are many manufacturers in South Africa that's actively working to get there, but we're just not there yet. So the BMW i8 it's really a car that that's technology advanced and has all the correct ingredients in there for you for a special car, but I just never took off. I never saw many of them on the road. Years after that, BMW still released many models, iterations of the i8. There was the i8, now the latest one was the i8 convertible. I feel the car just never really took off in South Africa. I wasn't wowed by the car when it came out. It also had the sound symposium inside the car, similar to what you get in a Ford, where it actually channels some of the noise of the engine noise inside the car. So it was really just, it wasn't the type of supercar I expected it to be. It wasn't like a Lamborghini. A Lamborghini, if you put your foot down, you've got a V10, that engine is just screaming. You can't hear yourself in the car. The things are falling around. It's chaotic. You feel like it's a chaotic, fast, super experience. And the i8 does not offer you that. When it came out, this car was priced at 1.7 million. Back then, I thought that was quite a lot for the car. And that car has lost almost half its value. You can pick that car up today for about 900,000 in 2019, which is an absolute bargain. The car lost almost half its value, and that's the same price as you would pay for a used F80 M3, for a C63 sedan. So it's really, if you're into a futuristic type of cars and you want to own something that's more of a once-off weekend type of vehicle, and you're looking at that price range, you're probably looking at R8s, you're probably looking at used GTRs, maybe 911s as well. If you're a tech type of guy and you like to save the planet, if you're a greenie, then the i8 might appeal for you. And it would be definitely the bargain of the year if you want to buy yourself an i8 today. That's our list. That's the five high performance cars that we feel never took off. They're all great cars. They're all cars that were destined for very big things, but unfortunately they take a huge depreciation knock. And if you're a performance enthusiast, if you're a car guy, if you like your fast cars, you like your special cars, well, now's the absolute time to snap up a bargain. What car would I pick from that list? It has to be the Golf 7 GTI Club Sport S. Yeah, it's not the fastest thing on the road. A Golf 7R with software is probably gonna smash me at the robot, but that's not why you buy that car. I buy it for the exclusivity. I would buy it for the fact that it's got a two-door and it's a bit more track-orientated. It is a bit more focused, and that would be my pick. Tell me in the comments what would be your pick from that five cars. My name is Kurt from wheelindex.co.za. I hope you enjoyed today's video. Catch you back next time. Cheers.